Hello. Today is the second part of my talk on things that can improve our brain, our thinking, and our learning. So in the first part, I was discussing about eating well. So eating well, then I was discussing about green tea. So green tea provides us with the thiamine, and you see, this thiamine is an amino acid that crosses the blood-brain barrier and acts on the connections, what are called synapses of the brain. So this leads to increased activity of GABA, so which is a neurotransmitter, and this increased activity of neurotransmitters makes you feel happy and elated, and so one is able to think well and learn well. Second thing is epigallocatechin. So this epigallocatechin is very interesting. So it just switches off the grief mode of the brain. So actually, like I am also learning and from the books and the net, because I thought it's an important topic. We have, say, it's not very clear, say 86 billion, 200 billion neurons, and every neuron having 1,000 to 10,000 connections. So this is a very great network of our processing machine. Will be very difficult to make a computer equivalent to working like that. So anyhow, question is that how we can improve our brain. So this switches off the grief mode. Now anybody who is sort of grieving over something, it's a very bad mode. So this switch off helps us to think well, because otherwise we so green tea, in addition to that, it increases our alertness, learning, performance, memory. It function of the brain gives us relaxation, a feeling of well-being, feeling of calm and focus. Now we come to the second thing after that, nuts. So you don't go nuts with nuts. Nuts actually are very helpful for the brain. They contain, one is fats, which are good for the brain, like omega fatty acids, omega-3 or omega-6 fatty acids, and many other trace elements. So the important nuts here, like groundnut, that has tryptophan. So this groundnut tryptophan, this is an essential amino acid and provides us with serotonin, which elevates our mood. And then this walnut. Now walnut, you see, walnut is when you break it, you find it's made like brain. I know you, the convolutions like gray matter on the walnut. Maybe God has made it for us, for our brains, and the idea is to consume it on regular basis, on maybe daily basis. So a walnut a day keeps diseases from your brain away, like they say, apple a day keeps the doctor away. So like that, it's a new thing which is striking my brain. Mind it, I have been delivering, now this is my fifth talk on brain, and I have been applying these fundas on myself, and I have even purchased some things, and other things I'm applying, and really I tell you that I am finding more relaxation, calm, focus, memory and recall, and relaxed thinking and better vision. You also try. So this walnut. Now this provides us with DHA. Now this is a very important thing. In walnut provides a DHA, which is sort of a omega-3 fatty acid. It is also rich in calcium, vitamin E, and antioxidants, which provide protect our brain cell neurons from damage by free radicals. Most of these provide antioxidants. So this walnut is very, very useful. Pistachio. This helps preserve brain essential minerals. Now this has a special thing is some provide minerals that helps to preserve brain essential minerals. Yes, so it increases our alertness, focus, sharpness, provides again antioxidants, prevents free radicals. Now then almonds and hazelnuts. So pistachio, we have considered hazelnut, almonds. Almonds is one of the most concentrated source of vitamin E. Vitamin E is concerned with longevity of life, being remaining young. So your brain will remain young. So almonds. So use nuts on daily basis. And it's not necessary to take very costly nuts if you cannot afford. Ground nut and peanuts also will help. You see, when I was abroad, there the rate of ground nut and peanut was same. And they didn't know that it is so available, cheap, you know, at less cost available in our country, India. But so people, those Europeans were, because that was more costly, almonds were cheaper and ground nut was costly. So, but still they were packing the suitcases with almonds and ground nuts there and going abroad, taking to their country when they were going back. They were from Eastern Europe at that time, Bulgaria, Romania, and this German places. So, but they knew the value of this thing. They, maybe it's their culture to use them. Now, this is about nuts. Now, fatty fish. Fatty fish, which is the mostly sea fish. Now, this fatty fish, I tell you, is very, very important. It contains very rich omega-3 fatty acids, vitamin A and D, and also amino acids, which are proteins, which are very good for the brain. Now, I think many of these are not very easily available in the land area of India or Asian countries. Some of the Asian countries, some of course take a lot of seafood. So I'll name them because my lectures and talks are heard by many people who can have accessibility to them and can afford them. So mackerel, salmon, cod liver oil. We also use, since my grandfather, maternal grandfather was an MRCP doctor from Ireland. And so he always used to send cod liver oil to my mother to be given to the children. At that time also they knew that the cod liver oil is good for the brain. So herring, sardines, tuna. I used to love when I was abroad, you know, the packed sardines which are eaten as a whole. You put it into the bread and just put it in the bread and eat like that with olive oil. They are already cooked and packed in the thing. Tuna also. Now they are not easily available at my place. Anchovy sauce. Anchovy is a small fish which is very salty and it is used in many ways. Anchovy sauce is a very popular side. Caviar. Now caviar is what? Caviar is the fish, they release their eggs inside the water. And so those eggs are collected and eaten. Very, very good source of all these things. So these fish, actually I have become vegetarian recently, but I am having a second thought when they are so good for the brain. So I think maybe I'll start taking some of these good fish as and well they are available. So fatty fish. So I've taken the names of the fish. Now the third thing, oysters. That's also a sea food and on the shores also you can find from the sea that can be harvested. Very rich in omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids, vitamin E and lot of important minerals which help to, you know, make our memory fluid and crystal. Two times of memory and brain working are there. One is fluid. Like I'm talking, it's flowing. Now something will become crystalline there inside the brain, make a crystal, precipitate. So these help the minerals, special minerals, they help in that. So fatty fish, soybeans. Now these soybeans, you see, they provide us with potassium, magnesium, vitamin K, folate, like eggs or meat they provide. Similarly, they are providing with folate, vitamin K, riboflavin and omega 6 fatty acids. But overeating of soya beans can have some side effect. This is not the topic of my discussion, but you can have soya beans in moderation. I've told you what do they provide for the brain, which is very useful. Now we come to blueberries. Now this thing is really wonderful because blueberries are also known as brain berries. Now this is a considered top brain food. And these increase the birth rate of neurons, especially in hippocampus area. Hippocampus area is wherever memory, long-term memory gets stored, indexed, coded, and then it is taken out from there, decoded, and we use it in our life. For example, I am a surgeon. I am not going to read every surgery every time. It automatically works. Somebody is a pilot. So every time he will not know that this instrument is this, this, and that they have to use in emergency measures. Suddenly the memory has to, they are trained on the simulators. So then when they train on the simulators, that memory goes inside on long-term memory. So blue brain berries, because of large activity here, there is turnover of neurons. Like neurons are used more, exhausted, so they become sometime useless and they are absorbed by, I am not going to that process. And but you need more and more neurons. So this increases birth rate of neurons, especially in hippocampus area of brain, which is the seat of storage of long-term memories. These reduce the genetic and biochemical drivers behind depression and suicidal tendencies, like post-traumatic stress syndrome. Now somebody has a trauma, mental trauma, physical trauma and stress, due to which, like they say, some actors have died, whether they have died or murdered. This is a big story going on in India. So this stress and trauma, sometimes somebody's heartbroken, loves a girl, girl say, no, you bloody fool, how did you think that you, I am, I you can deserve me. I'm so beautiful and you are so ugly. Oh, shock, trauma. So then you see, this trauma can lead to suicidal tendencies and depression. So these, they reduce genetic, which is through genes, and biochemical drivers, which are driving the depression and suicidal tendencies. What a beauty of these things. Blueberries. I have ordered blueberries to be brought to me. I can start consuming every day. So doses and all, how much you should consume is not I'm discussing today. You can go to the net. So not only blueberries, strawberries available in the season. I don't know if they're available dry or not, but we get in the season. Blackberries, black currants, mulberries. I like mulberries, very nice. Black mulberries, green mulberries. And so I had trees worn that, but since childhood, we have been taking mulberries. So these, please don't ignore berries from your diet if you want a good brain, healthy brain, stronger brain. Now, after that, we come to seeds. Now, seeds are something which are many times, thrown off. Like pumpkin seeds, for example, or sunflower seeds. Pumpkin seeds, a lot of pumpkin, eat the pumpkin and leave the seeds. This has been happening many times in I've seen in my family, because there was no knowledge. My mother never knew that these seeds are so useful. It's a pumpkin seed. They provide magnesium, iron, zinc, copper, antioxidant properties. So trace elements. So these are very good trace elements. Then chia seeds, they provide manganese, magnesium, selenium, and essential amino acids. They are rich source of amino acids. Now flax seeds, you see, richest source of omega-3, alpha, linolenic acid and omega-6 fatty acid. Flax seed, chia seed, they are the in things now. And my wife is a dietitian. She is advising them left and right to everybody. But I think this is a usefulness for the brain, especially those amino acids, those minerals which are required for the brain. They provide them. So seeds, don't ignore these seeds from your diet. Now this is regarding diet. which was the fourth topic which I was discussing in the first part. Now in the second part, new thing is sleep well. You know, you sleep well, you wake up fresh. So this is, I will tell you that this, usually whatever it is, the stress and excitement of a business, whatever business is what, business, busyness, whatever you are busy into. For example, I studied and prepared this lecture, but I was not satisfied. I searched more on the net. I have searched, say, 100 times more than this and concised it to give to you. So this, causes, insomnia. So business stress and excitement of business causes insomnia. You can't sleep that. You have to do something and you're going to achieve something. And the brain does not shut off. It keeps working like our, computer keeps working. So, but less sleep leads to less gray matter in the brain. The gray matter is there, the processing takes place, the neurons are there. So less gray matter, you have less intelligence, less memory, less, slow response time. All these things with the brain function. Brain function like frontal lobes. There is a formula, personality, reasoning, emotions, judgment, intelligence. So this is a few, many, many. All these things will go back. Now sleep consolidates memory and learning. Now this person, Walker, Alsop, Gab, and Stiglad, and such long. So they say that in 2005, they made study. And they found that, 7 to 9 hours of sleep. So 7 to 9 hours of sleep in a 24 hours, that helps you in better cognition, better memory storage and recall. Because this keeps on, the brain keeps on processing the memory offline. And you are not online and you are sleeping, you are offline. From your WhatsApp, Facebook, and other lines, you are going telephones. So brain needs to go offline. You also cannot be all the time on that, right? So offline. Now another thing is this Manoj et al. Et al. There are many names. I thought it's not good to write so many names here, and. Now, he says that the pattern of overnight plasticity. Now, what is plasticity? Plasticity is like children play with plasticine. That's a like dough. You can make different shapes of it. So, the brain keeps on processing the information, give it a shape and form, new forms, and new ideas, new imagination, new vision. So, associated with the sleep-dependent memory processing holds important implications for the learning of countless real-life motor skills. And also suggests its potential impairment or complete absence in psychiatric disorders. You see, now he taking a point, not only this person in 2004 says that our brain process helps us to learn motor skills and other, make them better. But he is giving another example. The example is that the people who are suffering from psychiatric disorders, now these people are having either lack of sleep or they are not able to sleep at all. So then he is indirectly trying to prove his point that psychiatric disorders are associated with lack of sleep. So if they can sleep well, maybe they can have psychiatric problem will be less. Or those people who sleep well may not have psychiatric problem. This is what this person is trying to say. And now, overnight plasticity, I've seen that the brain keeps on playing with your inputs of your own ideas, the memory stored here, and your sensory things. The person has spoken this thing, your boss or the person employed by you has given you this input, and this and that, these the pending jobs you have to do. Now we come to the other important points here. This I think is visible now.
Well, visible, maybe I will need that better visibility here. Now, this is some reflection of light. I'll put off this light. So, how is this? Now, this reflection is gone. Although a bit black, but upper portion is being seen well. This one, light slightly increased here. Right. So, this playing Tetris. Now, Tetris is a Russian game of shape and form type video game. Now, this Tetris MRI studies have proved by Biomed Center. It is called Tetris effect. Tetris effect in 2009, this study shows that those who play Tetris game, I think I'll put on the light, something okay, but the light is always better. So Tetris, those who play Tetris game, their gray matter thickens, means their neurons, more neurons are formed, and they are able to have more, place hard disk and processor and RAM in their brain, because the brain working motherboard is better. So these things, now regarding this playing of Tetris, I will say, now the team of researchers at Biomed Center conducted the study and of the brain of the participants of the study. The study tested two groups of people, one that played Tetris for 30 minutes a day and the others, one that didn't play at all. Now, looking at the MRI images, the researchers discovered the gray matter of the participants who played this game had thickened compared to those who didn't play it. Now, this is again interesting. The study concluded that Tetris can lead to physical cognitive development and also enhance memory capacity. Tetris has been found to induce this flexibility of brain matter by thickening it. The BMC study concluded that playing Tetris improved the function of the brain in a healthy way and allow it to operate more efficiently. That's good if the brain operates efficiently, because man is brain. Everybody needs a brain, politicians, industrialists, writers and teachers, who not? Everybody, even the fighter, even the sumo fighter will need some technique to fight. Just with a bulk, he just cannot fight. He's not a stone, or she's not a stone. Now, very important thing in this is the playing of these video games like Tetris is, now there is very important thing I am telling you. That is the prevention in built up of traumatic memories. Now, another research by Oxford in 2009 found that if the Tetris played soon after a traumatic event, like I earlier discussed, it, traumatic, somebody loses the loved one or is rejected or has a very big loss, in coronavirus period, there is, so keep playing something, keep your mind occupied. Okay, like I'm studying and delivering lectures, so my mind is occupied with this. I will do the research of reading and talk, lecture giving effect, Dr. Narottam Diwan. Okay, thank you very much if you appreciate it. Now, played soon after traumatic event. The preoccupation with the varied shapes of Tetris game, this is games, round, conical, triangular, square, rectangular, can prevent the recurrent recollection of traumatic images, like a video game plays through your mind about a traumatic image. Somebody has beaten you, abused you, you're the loss, but your something has gone up in flames. Like these traumatic events can be so many, thereby reducing the intensity and occurrence of traumatic reminders. It was discovered that Tetris changes the way sensory memories are formed in the period after trauma and decreases the number of flashbacks that are experienced afterwards. This is wonderful, because I think more than Tetris, keeping your mind occupied even when you have had some trauma or loss or anything like that, that something you keep on doing constructively, keep your mind occupied. So then you will be able to place something in your mind
and will not let, you know, like a space occupying me and think, you know, which will not let the bad memories, the memories of loss and hurt come to your mind, right? So this is regarding tetris, and thickening of gray matter is an advantage. Who doesn't want a good gray matter? Now, seven, high expectations. This is a Pygmalion effect. Now, Pygmalion was a Greek person. He used to cut the stones into shapes, and he made a beautiful shape of a beautiful lady in stone. But he, while making it, making the face, the lips and eyes and other parts, he fell in love with that stone sculpture. And so when he felt in love with stone sculpture, he wanted to marry that. This is mythology. Mythology means myth. In Hindi language also, we say mithya. Mithya means something not true, which is right or wrong, true or false. So this language in Greek or in English, myth, mythology, and in Hindi, mithya. So this myth is there, that stone sculpture came to life and he married her. Now, what does it convey? It conveys that the person worked and he put his mind to it to make a stone into a figure of a lady. I don't know this, they say 36, 24, 36 or something like that. Whatever shapes he gave, you know, everything beautiful, so beautiful that he wanted to marry her, and the stone came to life. So that means if the expectations of yourself, from yourself and the teachers and around are high and you work upon that, so then the brain, like that stone came to life, your expectations of your better thinking and brain functioning and outcomes will come through. This is very simple. High expectations, high outcomes. So, this also high expectation, there were experiments in the classes where they made groups of students and gave something to the students without expectation. They kept studying, and somebody, they gave some special thing and expected them to do solve those problem over the period of time. So this study is not very conclusive because very difficult. There are many other factors. Neuroscience is a developing science, but they say that it led to high performance. Now, eighth point, extended education. This is very important. Some people, mostly in our country, I'm sorry to say, I'm Indian, I love my country, but here the people are not that much interested in continued educations by themselves. Now the net is available, mobiles are there, smart, we can make them smart. Computers are available, but people are just gossiping or saying bad things about other people, about the government, relatives, friends, and the situation about the coronavirus, but they're not educating themselves. So extended education means you keep educating yourself, even the formal education, which is available through net, through the various courses. I know many doctors who have, 25, 30 degrees in various subjects. They have done the courses. My wife recently, at the age of 50, she first did diploma nutrition and health, and then master's in dietetics from the, you know, this on the without actively attending, you know, the courses. So this this thing, keeping yourself educated. Now, there was an experiment in Norway, Mr. Christian Brinch in Norway. So what did he do? What he did was that there was a change of a minimal time in education. And as this study says, it was applied to all the students of Norway. And this was increased from 7 to 9 hours per day. And this led to an increase of IQ by 3.7 points for every extra year of education. So when intelligence quotient will be high, so you are more intelligent. Nobody likes to be stupid and duffer. So one person, if you have to become, increase your intelligent quotient, you have to become more intelligent, you would have to take more education. That is for sure. Now, this is maintaining high level of mental activities. Now, maintaining how high level of mental activities? They say long-term stimulation of mind. Now, that doesn't mean that you start fighting with somebody and keep ushering, become angry. That is, anger is also occupation of mind. Frustration is also, anxiousness. No, not like that, not negative one. In a positive way, like involving yourself in purposeful conversation. Intelligent talk, interactive reading, you discuss with someone. I am discussing with myself and you are listening. If you will give me some feedback, I will be thankful. It will help my brain also, right? And contemplating what will happen next with high IQ and low EQ. Now, this is very thing. They say you to children, for example, you have to train for this thing or mental activity, you are doing something. So you are teaching them, reading them a story, you know. Okay, there was five lions in the forest and these five lions were walking. And suddenly 1,000 sheep, they decided today we will attack the lions. And they, lions were walking in a valley. So 1,000 sheep with their horns, they came running towards the lions and started poking their horns inside the lions. Lions ran, they were crying. No, what will happen next? Ask the child. Child may say that lions will soon attack and the sheep, some they will keep for eating, some they will kill, other sheep will run. Or they may say that the sheep will keep attacking even if they die and they will ultimately kill that. Lions will make them fear complex into them. So they will be very careful next time to attack a sheep. Now this will give an imagination to the child's brain. What happened? What will happen next? Don't complete the story yourself. This is an example. This can be applied to, for example, what will happen with coronavirus. Now what will happen next? Ask the question to yourself. Your brain will work. You will study what is happening to coronavirus. You will take the data and you will contemplate. This will help. So I think because we have to go and there has to be shortage of time, these things, I'm just giving you hints because these studies are very big studies, mental activities. Now, brain training. Now, brain training is a very, very, good method. And this method, this requires, training. Like one thing is, for example, I am sitting here. I can train my brain. I can think, number one, that what did I take in my breakfast today? Okay, that was maize bread along with some onions, garlic, and moringa, and black salt and pepper with it, and with the curds. That's why I took two. Then I go back to what did I eat yesterday night, yesterday afternoon, yesterday morning. Then you keep your brain relaxed. Similarly, what did you do? What that person said? The person you met, what type of clothes they were putting? This is simple. But you can have games like that. They will have simple forms. For example, triangle, star, hash, with the, so when the rectangle of different colors, so when that is repeated, you have to press a button. So these can be made complicated. So these things, how to train your brain, you can use your smartphones in the Google feed. How to train your brain, video games, videos, literature, and it will come to you. Because this is too big a topic and I cannot cover it here. Just you're telling you that this training of brain, especially, by trying to understand the point of view that you do not agree with and trying to find sense in it and argument that makes no sense to you, trying to find some sense in the argument that makes no sense to you. increasing your brain plasticity. Again, plasticine, like it is fixed, like this idea is right. Yeah, that person is told this thing wrong. So you think maybe there is some element of which is not wrong in this. And ultimately, you may find that he was totally or she was totally right and you were wrongly thinking. So this gives plasticity, flexibility to your brain so that it can adapt to previously unexperienced events. So now suddenly you find an person to deal with a situation which you have no experience with. Because your brain has dealt with such matters, solved these problems, where it was fixed, it will help you to solve this problem. This is also neuropsychology. Good for me, so I'm studying. If you like, it can be good for you. Right? No stress, no smoking. That's very important. Smoking, you know, reduces oxygen supply, has so many toxins that kill the neurons, make them distorted. They don't function well. Most of the diseases of the brain, whether that is, attention deficit disorder, ADD, or the neurosis or psychosis, mania, the anxiety, they are related to this, smoking. And not only smoking, that smoking of this marijuana, which is being legalized in many places, cannabis, and other intoxicants, even alcohol, is very bad for the brain. You read it on the net. Wernicke's atrophy of the brain. Brain may have going to complete atrophy and you may have dementia. So these things are being promoted by the industry and the governments because the taxes they are gaining through this. And they're not bothered about the people becoming stupid, their brains dying off or the people dying off other things. But here is a data. The data of dementia. Those who smoke two packs or more have double the chances of developing dementia. Dementia means brain is gone. You become a brainless person. And especially in the old age, if you become brainless, you cannot take care of yourself. How to clothe, how to eat, how to take bath, how to shit, how to, all these things. Your own money will be taken away. You will be attacked. You will be vulnerable. So this dementia is very bad. So one pack or more, 44% more chances. Even the lowest level of smoking, 37% more chances of developing dementia. This is a very, very big problem. Don't smoke, man. Not only cancers and other problems. I have seen with smoking people, blue bloaters. So they become blue totally. Because I have spent some time in medicine also, which was in Government Medical College, Patiala Medicine. 6 months I did house job in 1979. And so I saw blue bloaters, pink puffers, where the hemoglobin keeps going up and they become pink, like mountain people, pink puffers. I've seen them, plenty of them. And this chronic lung diseases, I'm not going to detail. But smoking is very, very bad for your brain also. Can develop dementia. Don't smoke, man, don't smoke. Don't give your gift of your life to the taxes, to the people who are giving you something which kills your brain and your body and life. Now having a stress-free life. Now this stress-free life, stress generates a lot of corticosteroids, adrenaline, and constricts the supply to your brain. And the neurotransmitters are depressed. So this brain functioning is depressed. The brain is occupied with stress. And since it is occupied with stress rather than good thoughts, so it doesn't function. You can become blocked. The memory is not stored. Memory is not retrieved. There is activity decreases. The brain goes down. I'm not taking too much this thing into that. So well controlled diabetes mellitus, hypertension, lipid. This is good because I'm discussing good things. So stress-free is good and well controlled diabetes mellitus, hypertension and lipids are good. I have discussed in my previous talks the bad effects of diabetes mellitus, hypertension, lipid. When you control it well, it's good for you. Sunlight, early to bed and early to rise. Because morning gives you, open up the mind, give you a good feeling. The birds are flying off their nests and the greenery is there. There is not much smoke and noise. But in the light, the brain is better. But sunlight gives you vitamin D. And so the more the exposure, the more you get vitamin D. It depends upon which place in the world you are, how much you can expose. You can go to the beach or not, beach in how many clothes, and how many clothes you have to wear, whether you are just an indoor bird or you walk outside, what time. And he reminded the sunscreens which we use that block the rays that create vitamin D. Vitamin D is very good for our brain and very good even for infection control, like in coronavirus, you should have your vitamin D level checked up. If they are less, have vitamin D. Okay, so well controlled this sunlight. And 15th is protection from injuries. Now, when you keep your brain, this brain God has put, you see this, are you listening to this voice? This is skull. So God has protected this brain inside the skull. So there are many other functions of skull because it gives a cooling effect that I'm not discussing to the brain because it acts. So the brain is very active, it needs protection. So this shell, inside the shell, muscle, this muscle is not in this shell, right? So nose is not on the shell. There is no outer shell. Some people like crocodile, tortoise, they have outer shells. So brain is got an outer shell. So what the injuries can damage, although later on the recovery may take place or may not take place, it may cause some permanent loss of some part of the brain or collection of blood, pressure on the brain. It can be fatal immediately. I have been into neurosurgery department for 6 months in CMCH. In 1983, and I have seen so many people losing everything, their memory and all. But they may recover. But protection from injuries, unnecessary injury like protection from fall, reckless driving in your bathroom, you should not let the soap and the oil spill on the floor. So these precautions, please take. This concludes my lecture on the second lecture on the things that improve your brain. Please, if you have liked it, press the like button. If you have liked it and you want to that and you think it can benefit your friends and relatives, those who are concerned, please share it on your Facebook, WhatsApp, and on your YouTube channels, right? And you can support me to deliver you more lectures by liking it, by sharing it, and by subscribing to my channel. I have been giving talks and giving a lot of things on this YouTube channel. So I request you to support me by liking it, sharing it, and subscribing to my channel so that I can continue to deliver more lectures. Thank you very much. Bye-bye for now. Wishing you a happy and healthy brain.